since in the year 2000, opened it in August of 2002, and it's been the home of this franchise ever since. Welcome to NRG Stadium in Houston. Coming up, we've got what should prove to be a good one between the Indianapolis Colts and the Houston Texans. And he'll take this one near the 25, call it the 26-yard line. Miller, the lone setback. And they'll give it to him here. And he'll push his way forward to about the 32. 5 yards is the tally on first down. That brings up second and five. So the pickup there for Lamar Miller, and he actually shredded his current team last year when he played against him. 175 yards, another 61 in the air, and 2 touchdowns.
I guess that's a classic example of if you can't stop him, go get him, put him on your team. Lamar Miller, a big-time pickup for the Texans.
On second down, here's Osweiler. And in the left side, Fedorowicz has it. And able to get this one across the 45 before he's brought down.
And there's a completion to the tight end. And look at the size of these players nowadays. At that spot, 6'4", 6'5", and up. A lot of guys used to be basketball players, somehow came back to football. That's really good for the game of football. You're getting better athleticism, great hand-eye coordination. Guys who know how to control their bodies when they run their routes.
Throwing, Osweiler, and his throw is incomplete. The Pro Bowler DeAndre Hopkins, the intended receiver. And now it's second down. Second down following the incompletion. Play action, now Osweiler. Surveying the field. He's going to float this one deep right side. Got his man. It's the rookie Fuller. Touchdown, Houston. Will Fuller, 54 yards. And the Texans have taken the early lead. And they use that height on the outside to get the score.
We've seen the evolution of the wide receivers. They've gotten taller and taller, but they've retained their quickness and their speed. It's a lethal combination.
Always good to have wide receivers with height. It's Novak on. He'll send this one away following the touchdown. This will be taken in at the one. And the Colts getting ready to go. They'll come out in the pistol. Luck on first down. Caught left side by Hilton. And he's taken down, but not before he gets this across the 25-yard line. And T.Y. had what proved to be the game winner against Chicago. He burned Jacoby Glenn, a backup corner, all the way to the end zone, 35 yards, and the Colts went out on top.
He does have a flair for the dramatic, doesn't he? His first touch in college at Florida International, a punt return for a touchdown. And how about the play he made, as you just described, against Jacoby Glenn? Ultimately, the game-winning touchdown.
Now the first carry here for Frank Gore. And he's going to lose yards. They take him down at the 26. That's going to go as a loss of 2, and it'll be second down.
As a guy carrying the ball, your eyes are going to direct your feet, and you're hoping they carry you to the open spaces. But it's awfully difficult at times because you have so many things you have to look out for. Where's the line blocking? Where's the traffic coming from? Tough to find open spots.
On second down, here's Locke. And Dwayne Allen on the ground. And he's brought down after a good gain.
It looks to me, Brad, like Dwayne Allen is really starting to come into his own as a tight end. Kind of reminds me of a previous Indianapolis Colts quarterback tight end connection, because what he's doing with Andrew Luck, They really find each other quite well.
Against Chicago, most catches he's had all year, 6, and then 50 yards and a touchdown as well. Now a play fake here on first down. Right back for Allen. This time he finds him complete. So holding by the offense, and maybe now got to shift up what you want to do on the playbook.
Yeah, definitely. Change what you're doing on the playbook, but boy, the advantage shifts to the guys on defense, doesn't it? Longer yardage situations, they often become bolder.
And now a first down following that long gain. A shotgun snap for Luck. It's a short one here, complete to his tight end. It'll be a gain of 4, and it'll be a second and long.
Got to give credit where it's due. Really nice defense on that play. The pitch and catch was successful, but not any run after it.
Completed pass play. Now let's see if they go back to the air or to the ground. Now on second down, this is Gore. And he'll take this one up close to about the 45. It's a gain of 4, but they're still looking up here at a tough 3rd and 11. Against Chicago, Gore moved into 9th all-time in the NFL rushing list, Charles. 12,368 rushing yards.
Think about some of the names he's passed in recent weeks. Marcus Allen, Edgerrin James. Frank Gore's had a terrific career. And how about him getting this done after the game in London? No open week. I mean, I take an open week after London, don't you?
Absolutely. It's a loss of 10 on the sack, and it leads to 4th. And their inaugural sack of the game coming from an unlikely source.
You mean it wasn't a linebacker? It wasn't a defensive end?
It was somebody like you.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, that's a surprise for the offense. That's not what they normally get when they think about pressure.
Back with Charles Davis, I'm Brandon Gauden. The Colts in possession of the football to begin quarter number 2. They are, however, facing a 4th down situation. And this is going to hit the goal line and continue on into the end zone for a touchback. So we'll get another look at the Texans on offense. Yeah, I mentioned it earlier, 3-2 on this young season. Those 2 losses, though, big margins, 31-13 against the Vikings, and then way back against the Patriots, 27-0.
And I think what you just noted there, the big margins, that's the cause for concern for Texans fans, because they want to be competitive. If you lose to New England or Minnesota, that's not such a big deal. But to get blown out by both of them, that raises some eyebrows.
Yeah, and the wind's coming over the Bears, the Chiefs, and the Titans. It's a 6-yard pickup, and it gets them to 2nd and 4.
Some runs are blocked so well, you almost forget that someone has to carry the ball to gain the yardage. The leverage by the offensive line to create space up front, really well done.
They go play action with Osweiler. He's got it complete to Braxton Miller. And he's brought down. That one good for 16, and the drive will continue. Well, clearly one of his advantages as a passer is his height, sit back in the pocket, fired over the middle. That makes things tougher defensively, doesn't it?
It really does, because your goal is to move the quarterback off his initial spot when he gets his drop back completed. But when you have that type of height, he can stay in there if he's willing to take the hits and just fire over the top, which saves him time and actually completes a play a little bit quicker than it normally does for a quarterback that has to slide and find open space to throw. And there's a run to be happy with. Good, solid yardage. He'll take that anytime you hand the ball to a back.
2nd down of the offense, needing 5 yards. Now it's Osweiler. He's got time. And on the left side, Fedorowicz has it. And he's brought down after a good game. That goes for a gain of 31.
There will always be a place for methodically marching the ball downfield. But when you can pick it up in big chunks and strike like that, have explosive plays, that's often the difference in winning and losing. Those types of plays that can knock a defense off balance, that'll drive a team towards a victory.
A 1st down carry now for Miller. And he'll keep it moving down to the 15-yard line. It's a 7-yard carry to set them up with a 2nd and 3.
This drive is turning into an extended one, and the guy carrying the ball, he's becoming more like a body blows guy. Every carry is putting some damage on the defense. So after a while, I'm not too sure how many guys are going to want to run up and tackle him.
Play clock hit 0. Don't know what went wrong there, Charles, but it's going to cost some 5 yards.
Has to be some organization from the sideline. Sometimes when you're trying to decide on what play to send in, the play caller has to move a little bit faster.
It's a 5-receiver set, 3 to the left, 2 to the right.
Green, 39.
On 2nd down, here's Osweiler. It's caught, Fedorowicz. And they've got it inside the 10 at the 8. It's a nice pickup of 12 yards, and it gives them a 1st and goal. And here comes play number 6 on this drive. Throwing, Osweiler. That's caught at the 1. It's a gain of 7, and it'll be 2nd and goal. And Hopkins, a Pro Bowler from a year ago, found the end zone in week 5, 56 yards receiving.
You know, in 2015, he had to adjust to 4 different quarterbacks, taking snaps for Houston. Now he has Brock Osweiler. They're still trying to get their connection down pat, but he still knows how to find the end zone.
Blue 90.
They'll try to punch it in with Miller. And this one will wind up with him losing yardage. Back to the 4-yard line. It's a loss of 4. Now 3rd down.
On goal-to-goal runs, when you create lost yardage plays, the only way that happens is either called pressure or what I like to call straight ahead pursuit. A great read, and they get to the backfield and make the play.
And that was a big chunk of yardage loss. On 3rd and goal, Osweiler. And he'll just toss it away. So he throws it away, and that brings up 4th down.
It's a tried and true formula, and I don't think it'll change for as long as we play football. If someone's trying to throw the ball and you can put pressure on them and make it tough, that's only going to help your defense.
Yeah, he's since being hurried. He got rid of it before taking the hit, but incomplete. And the 10-year vet knocks it through the goalpost, and the lead moves to 10-0. So give them 3 there. A good drive gets them inside the 5, but they couldn't punch it in.
And credit this defense, too. That was the old bend but don't break approach, but it kept the offense out of the end zone.
Now it's Nick Novak back out following his field goal to send it away. Quan Bray now to return this football. And a pretty good return here. He'll be stopped just shy of the 25 at the 24-yard line. Here comes the Indianapolis offense now as they get set to take over. And what do you think goes on here in this situation? If you got the football, you're trailing, you're back in your own territory with just a little time. Do you try something?
You're thinking about jump-starting your team, right? You just mentioned it. They're down. They're trying to get back into the game. But you've got to figure, if something goes wrong, you may have put yourself in a spot where you may not be able to come back in the 2nd half. Managing risk is a big decision here.
Philip Dorsett hauls it in. It'll go as a gain of 12, and it'll give the Colts a 1st down.
Partner, this is one of the best routes anyone can have in their offensive playbook. Tough to defend because you think it's a go route, and then he breaks it back on the comeback. There's one other thing you need as well.
A well-thrown ball.
Exactly right. Got a guy who has some precision in throwing the football because of the timing of the route.
Here's Luck. And the tip there altered the ball flight, and it falls incomplete. It'll be 2nd down. Well, a few weeks ago when we sat in the booth, I asked you a couple weeks in, how were the rookie quarterbacks adjusting? And the answer was pretty well. What have you thought now so far?
Well, Dak Prescott leads the pack. His team has won four straight, and he still has yet to throw an interception. It's absolutely remarkable what he's done through the first five games. You look at Carson Wentz, finally threw an interception, but I thought he played well in their loss in Detroit. He continues to mature as a rookie quarterback, looking more and more like a veteran. And Paxton Lynch got his first start in Denver. Didn't go quite the way he wanted, but at least he's got his feet wet now.
First down and 10 now for the offensive group. On first down, it's Locke. Over the middle, Dorsett. And he'll get it inside the 40 to the 39. Now hold everything here. We're going to get a timeout by the offense. So that means they're down to one remaining here as we head toward halftime. Second down now after the pass completion. They come out five wide, three of them to the right side. To the air again, Locke. And his pass incomplete. T.Y. Hilton, the intended receiver, and it's third and four. And the Texans have an extra defender in the secondary now on third down. Play fake to Turbin. Now Locke. Backing up. He's going to go for a big play. Wide open. Complete. And he takes this one in for a Colts touchdown. Their dangerous wide receiver. 39 yards. And the Colts able to get this back within a touchdown. Now Adam Vinatieri for the point after. And they're back within a field goal. It's 10-7 now. Now after the touchdown, here's Pat McAfee to kick. This is fielded a couple yards deep. And with a new rule, that decision to bring it out will cost him about 5 yards as he only gets to the 20. The Texans offense now, they get set to head back onto the field. And the ball backed way up. So thinking with this amount of time on the clock, probably just sit on it and we'll see these two teams go to the lockers.
Yeah, I don't think you want to overthink it in this situation. Either side of the ball, just go ahead and finish up the half and get on out and talk about it.
They'll start out on the ground. It's Lamar Miller. And a short gain there as he'll get it up only to about the 24. Yeah, give him 4 yards there. It'll be second and six.
Not a run that you're going to write home about, but still a good first down run. That's what an offense calls staying on schedule. 3 to 4 yards on first down, you're set up very well for the rest of the drive.
So we've come upon halftime here in Houston, and it's the home team, the Texans, leading this one. As we send you on over to Orlando, where we'll check in with Larry Ridley. He's got our EA Sports halftime report. Larry, this is fielded at the goal line. Oh, what a move. And he's up past the 20 to the 22-yard line. Out come the Colts. They'll have it first here to start quarter number three. They're down here, but very much in this game. What's the tonality of a coach's talk when a game is within striking distance like this at intermission?
It's typically what they're doing is emphasizing the things that went well in the first half and wanting more of that. Sure, you've got to go over some of the errors and clean up some things because there's a reason you're down. But overall, I think they want to stay positive, stay up with this team. We're just starting the second half. And
Rush coming, and he's taken down. Brian Cushing coming hard on the blitz. He dumps him for a loss of 8. Man, he got in there so quickly, Charles. What could the offense have done to adjust and account for that?
But what you're hoping is that you figure out and you see and get a clue that maybe there's going to be some pressure coming at you, and you change the blocking schemes. Maybe you go to max protection. The biggest ones, maybe you bring your running back in to try and keep you clean. But in that case, that didn't happen. Zero accountability, and a sack resulted.
And he'll get to the 29-yard line, brought down there. Give him 16 yards on the play, and that'll bring up a third down.
And when you're playing a quarterback with some experience and some moxie, you enter the danger zone when you decide to blitz him, because if he's able to diagnose as he did on that play, he can hurt you downfield.
He reads defenses so well, doesn't he?
He really does, and the best part about that play for him, I don't think that was his primary target.
I don't think so either.
I think he had the read, figured out where the blitz was coming from, and went to a secondary target for a really nice game.
So a little grabbing there, but this time it goes against the offense for holding.
Well, that wasn't just a loss. That was a loss of big yardage there. So the sense you're starting to get is that offensively, things are starting to pile up against them, and they've got to find a way to stop that. Conversely, how about the great call by the defensive coordinator? He realized that he's got him on the run a little bit. That call was made to get upfield penetration by his defensive front to try and get into the gaps, get upfield into the backfield, and make a big play. I think that was actually called, not so much just to get it done that way, but to say, hey, guess what? We're going to be aggressive, and we had an opportunity and seized it. So much about this game is just understanding situations and then having to execute, isn't it? Guard the first down sticks. Don't let them get there. And they rallied and made the tackle.
Here's Pat McAfee now. On for his second punt, he'd take a repeat of his first. Fielded at the 20. That's going to go in the books as a 55-yard punt. Well done. And the Texans take possession. So here's the Texans offense now. They get set to start this third quarter. They have the lead here. Well, we talk a lot about pregame speeches. What are halftime speeches like?
For the most part, not nearly as emotional. They're a lot more clinical. Every now and then, though, they'll get after you if they think they need to light a fire. But in this case, let's go into the virtual locker room, because here's what I think happened. They got in there and they said, listen, let's take control right away.
We got the lead.
Defense, don't give up any points. Turn the ball back over to the offense and let them go down and score and give us more of a cushion in the game. Check so far. Defense shut them down. Let's see what the offense gets done.
And they still need 8 yards for the first here on second down.
All right, here we go. 3-19.
Out of the gun, it's Osweiler. It's complete to Fuller. And they're able to get this one across the 35. Give them 12 yards on that one. It earns him a fresh shut of downs. And boy, they had high praise for this rookie receiver when we asked the coaches about him, didn't they?
They certainly did. And obviously, they liked his measurables. Otherwise, they wouldn't have brought him onto the team. Height, weight, speed, all of that. But how about what they really said? Competitiveness. That's what they really liked about him. The way he goes after the football, competes for it, and decides when it's in the air, it's his and only his.
They isolate Hopkins on the left side.
Right, here we go. Green, 39.
From the shotgun, Osweiler. Miller on the catch over the middle. And he'll go down right around the 47 this time. That one good for 14 yards. And it'll be second and about a yard. And that's one of his advantages of a passer, is now with his height, setting back there in the pocket, firing it over the middle, he can really see everything clearly.
It is, and I know that other quarterbacks get it done different ways, all right? You don't have to be his height to make a great play, but what he does is he takes away having to make those slide steps in the pocket. to find angles to throw the ball through. He just throws right over the top of it because he can see everything, and sometimes that saves time and gets the ball to a receiver quicker.
Osweiler now to throw on third down. He finds his target, Fuller. And he'll take this one in for a Texans touchdown. Will Fuller, his second touchdown of the night, and the Texans will add on to their lead. Well, it was third and one. I was expecting runs so much for that. They pass it, they score it.
That had the feel of the head coach telling the offensive coordinator, you've got four downs here. We're going to go for it on fourth down unless there's a disaster on third. Go ahead and take a shot if you want to. And he gratefully accepted the opportunity and did exactly that. If they didn't get it there, that had the feel that they would come back and try it on fourth down.
Now it's Novak on. He'll send this one away following the touchdown. This will be taken in at the one. And a nice return sets him up pretty good here at the 30-yard line. And the Colts coming out now. And on the last go-around, they really couldn't get anything going.
They had to punt from deep inside their own territory, which means you're going to lose the field position battle as a general rule. What they're looking for now is a little more consistency. Move the ball at least a few times on offense, get a couple of first downs, and hopefully flip the field.
Yeah, just something to build off of. That's what they're looking for here. Time to establish the run game. It's Gore. And he'll work this one up to about the 38. 9 yards is the pickup there, and they'll have a second and one.
Now, that's a run that warms a play caller's heart because you're actually set up to do whatever you want on offense. You can come right back and run essentially the same play because you have momentum. Or you can fake that running play and throw something deep over the top. Or you now feel like you have an extra down to play with. Because if you go ahead and just throw it and you don't get it, come back and try and pick it up on third down.
Back now in Houston, it's the Colts. So they've got the football, but they've got work to do. Trailing here as we begin the fourth quarter. Draw. Luck gives to Gore. And he's brought down. They pick up 12 on the play there, and they move the chains.
I thought guys that were over 30 weren't supposed to run the football this well in the National Football League. How about that veteran leadership? A big-time run combined with some nice blocking by his offensive line, showing that the ins and outs of being a veteran still has his place in this league. His odometer is not totally turned over yet.
They go play action here on first down. And he just gets rid of it. Throws it away. A wise move there. Looked like nobody open. Now second down.
I hope I don't sound too rah-rah on that one, but that's the exact right throw. Either your receiver gets it or no one gets it. Give him a lot of credit for being really precise with it.
Got rid of it. No one got it. From the 50, it's Luck. He's got time in the pocket. Under pressure, and the Texans able to get in there for the sack. Christian Covington in there to sack him for a loss of 6.
Partner, I know the ball security is preached like crazy, but every now and then you've got to know when to get rid of the football and save a little bit of yardage if you're a quarterback.
Because now if you're the offensive coordinator, what does it do if it was third and 10 versus third and much longer as it is now?
Yeah, it changes everything in terms of play calling and the pressure you might expect to face on the very next down. Had to throw the ball away and save the yardage. He didn't get it done.
It'll be a gain of 6, and it'll be fourth down.
That's certainly playing down and distance very well by the defense, isn't it? Take whatever you want underneath, by all means.
And they're indeed going to go for it here on fourth down. So trailing here in the last quarter, let's see how this plays out. Desperation time for Luck on fourth down. And Allen's got it. It'll be a gain of 15 on the play. And on fourth and long, somehow they're able to keep the drive going. And that's what you've got your tough little slot receiver for, isn't it? Right there, those fourth down conversions in the middle of the field.
He knows that's where he has to make his living, and that's where he has to make plays to help his team. And no one is asking him to do anything more or less than do exactly what we saw there.
Now a play fake here on first down. He's going to look deep down the field. And incomplete, he dropped it in the end zone.
On every offensive coordinator, every play caller sheet, they have about 5 or 6 plays per game that they call shot plays or big plays. And you don't get many opportunities to dial them up. And they just did. And they drop it with a great chance to make a big play. That's going to hurt.
Second and 10, Luck again. They go with the screen to Gore. And this play will be blown up. He'll lose yardage back at the 38. They'll wind up losing 3. And now it's third down.
Time to give a little credit here. That was an excellent read by the guys on the defensive side of the ball.
Are you crediting your defense?
Gotta credit them on that one because they tried to fool them, right? Tried to trick them. Ran a screen, and they went to it and smothered it for a loss of yardage.
Third and long, it's Luck. Now they set up the screen, that's complete. And he's going to go out of bounds, taking it down inside the 25. They get 14 yards there and a first down. And in a two-score game, obviously, every play, every third down, like we saw there, magnified, big pickup.
It was a huge pickup. What they really want, though, is to not even get to third down. They've got to maximize time and conserve as much as possible.
Luck on first down. He hits Devin Street. Give him 16 on the pickup. And the Colts are going to have a first and goal.
In recent years, the slot receivers really gained stature in the NFL because they could do so many things. Yes, they can line up wide like your normal wide receiver, but to have that kind of courage and toughness to run routes in the middle of the field and become dependable targets for their quarterbacks and move the sticks, those guys are worth their weight in gold.
Luck throwing again. And he's got his man. It's Hilton for the Colts touchdown. T.Y. Hilton, a 7-yard touchdown grab. And the Colts have got it back to a 1-score game. Well, that's about as quick of a passing touchdown as you'll ever see right there.
Everyone has a section in their playbook called the quick game. That was a super quick game. Out of the hands of the thrower, bam, right to the receiver, successfully for a touchdown.
How in-depth is that quick game part of the playbook?
It's pretty in-depth because people want the ball out of the hands of the quarterback into the playmaker's hands downfield as fast as possible. There are a lot of plays, a lot of options involved with that.
Now after the touchdown, here's Pat McAfee to kick. This fielded a few yards into the end zone. And he'll be brought down at the 23, make it the 24-yard line. They begin with a run by Miller. And that winds up a decent run, and it also takes us to the 2-minute warning. And now here's a timeout called by the Colts on the defensive side of the ball. It's just their first. They've got 2 more to use here in the final stages. Miller. It'll be a pickup of a couple, and it leaves him with a 3rd and 3. And another timeout taken by the Colts. That'll leave them with just one remaining in this fourth quarter of play. So second down was a run play. Now let's see what they do on third. They come out here in the eye. They'll try to run for it with Miller. And he'll get this up only to about the 33. And play is stopped here. Timeout. It's the defense calling the timeout here. That'll be their third and final stoppage here as we step aside. Here's Shane Leckler now, as he's on to punt for the first time tonight. Yards on the punt there, and the Colts are going to take over, albeit deep in their own territory. And now Indianapolis set to take the field. Last time they were out, they scored. Still trailing here, though, so some work to do.
But it's okay in terms of mindset. Because they scored the last time, they're not quite as worried about being down on the scoreboard because now their confidence is a little bit higher. They feel like they've got something going, and they feel like they can attack again and put more points on the board.
Are you scoreboard watching if you're the offense, or are you just focused on this drive?
We wouldn't be telling the truth if we said that they didn't scoreboard watch. Everyone does it to some extent, but you've got to set it aside right now and just focus on this series. That'll take care of the scoreboard if they punch it into the end zone.
So the incomplete pass brings up second down. They'll look to throw. Finding time. Now a desperation throw deep downfield. And incomplete there. A nice hit. Jars the ball free and brings up third down.
Well, they went for the big play there, but that drop could really hurt their momentum.
And the offense looking to pick up the first down after the second down incompletion. So a third and 10, and defensively a dime look, six DBs. Now we've got whistles and a flag. Looked like one of the Colts linemen might have jumped. And on the outside, they're playing press coverage. So third and 15, and an extra defensive back in the game now.
Flooding the passing lanes.
He's back to throw. And he's got his man, Hilton. And he gets this one all the way up to the 40. A big gain of 31 on third down. And they're going to hurry back to the line now. Back to throw. Surveying the field. A dump down to Turbin. Oh, look at the strength.
No, no, no.
And he is out of bounds inside the 35. And he did exactly what they needed him to do, Charles. Got out of bounds. They have no timeouts.
And they knew that before the play even began. Still executed it. How many times have we seen it happen where you know it, yet a guy's still looking for a timeout or trying to stay in bounds? He got it done.
Back to throw. He's got time. And he can't get a throw away. He's taken down. Whitney Mercilus in there to take him down. And the clock will roll. And some secondary help here for the defense in the nickel on third and long. He'll look to throw. He's got time in the pocket. Completes it to Moncrief, left side. And he gets it down to the 32. It'll be a gain of 8 yards, and that'll bring up fourth down. He had time, was able to survey the field, and find a soft spot in that zone coverage.
And that's where it gets difficult for a defender, Brandon. You go to your spots on the field that you have to cover, and when the offense finds an area that you're not in, that's where they throw the football.
And here in overtime, if the team that receives the ball scores a touchdown, it's over. If they don't, we can still have some more football.
That's exactly right. If they go down and kick a field goal, the other team gets a possession to either match it or score a touchdown to win the ball game. If both teams kick field goals, the next team to score wins. But if the receiving team throws a pick six or fumbles the ball and it gets picked up by the defense and they score, the game is over at that point.
And he'll take this up past the 20 and down at the 22-yard line. And now Indianapolis set to take the field. They're set for their first drive here in overtime. And this is where the crowd can really become a factor.
They've had to battle it all day, but I know what you're saying. In overtime, that gets doubled, doesn't it? At least, because now the crowd really wants to be involved and help their team. And that first drive can dictate the whole thing, because they know if this team takes it downfield and scores a touchdown, it's game over.
It's been loud in here so far. 2 yards on the carry there. It'll be second down.
That's a good play by the guys on the defensive side of the ball. Held them to a gain of 2. And that changes the playbook a little bit now for the guy calling plays. Second and 8. Now he's got to probably think about going to the air instead of maybe staying with the ground game.
See if they stay on the ground for second down. They come out with 1 back and 3 tight ends. Another carry now for Gore. And he'll fight forward to about the 27-yard line. Give him 3 on the run there. Now they're looking at a 3rd and about 5.
I think we know by now that every run is not going to be broken and get all the way to the end zone. But these short ones still have their value. You can still set up your play action and throw the football. You control the clock because you have the ball and they don't. And often the physicality sets the tempo for the game.
First throw in overtime for Locke. Caught left side by Hilton. And he's got the first before he's brought down at the 39-yard line.
I don't care how many times we see it. I still get a kick out of watching quarterbacks and receivers do the pass tree in pregame warm-up. But I always remember that when we go to practices, we see that after practices as well. They really tune it up, don't they?
They tune it up. They know why they do it for these situations. First down.
And they build that trust, and that's why they're able to find him in this type of a situation.
And he'll push this forward only to about the 42-yard line. Give him a couple on the carry there. Second and 8.
We know that old expression, it's not my night. It hasn't been his so far. I don't know if the legs are a little bit heavy. Sometimes having to hang out all day and play doesn't exactly play to your advantage, but it's been a tough go for him.
And every time he looks up, somebody's there defensively. That was the same case on that play. On second down, here's Locke. Complete to Hilton. And he'll be down deep in Houston territory. A huge play there in overtime, 47 yards.
Coaches really don't care from what position they get this, but run after the catch ability, rack ability, is often the difference between winning and losing and changing field position.
On first down, it's Gore. And this play goes nowhere. Losing yardage back to the 15. A loss of a full 3 yards, and now it's second down.
To me, that's a superior play by the backer because he was allowed to, I think, run free on it and make that play. His defensive linemen, they covered things down for him because offensive guys, the linemen, what they're trying to do, as you know, is block the guy at the point of attack and then climb to the next level and get the linebacker. When you're not allowed to climb, you got a free hitter, and that's what we saw there, and a really nice play resulted for them.
Here's Luck now on second down. Deep drop. Look at the time. This will be caught just inside the 10. So he got his hands a little too far outside. The ref caught him, threw the flag.
Well, that wasn't exactly a work of art, was it?
No, that wasn't a thing of beauty. That's just why I don't play in points per reception fantasy league.
Is that what they call PPR?
Receiver still gets a point there. Yeah.
Oh.
And you went that far back. No bueno.
But I'll tell you what, I wish I had their defense on my fantasy game.
The penalty, it's Gore, and he's going to lose yards. They take him down at the 26. It'll be a loss of a yard, and they're going to be staring at a third and long here.
What a tremendous play by the defensive line. Instead of getting too far upfield against the draw, able to hold their spot and make a big play in the backfield.
Seventh play of this drive coming up, but a long way to go on third down. Play fake to Turbin, now Luck. He's going to take a shot for the end zone. And that is out of the back of the end zone, incomplete. So here comes the trusty, battle-tested Adam Vinatieri for a big kick. This to at least get him a lead here in overtime. And Vinatieri's kick is good. And with that, they take the lead here 20-17. All right, so they're able to put three on the board here on the opening drive of OT, and now it'll be up to their defense to try and see this one out.
So remember now, a field goal on this next drive would get us to sudden death. Any kind of turnover or turnover on downs would end the game, as would any touchdown. So this one's still very much up in the air.
Here's the punter McAfee to kick it away. That'll be taken in the end zone. And a couple yards deep, he'll go to a knee. He won't return it. And they'll take it out to the 25. And now out comes Houston. The field goal would push it to sudden death. We just saw the field goal on the other end, but I don't think they are thinking field goal. At least not to start this drive, they're not thinking field goal.
Not at all, because your point is well taken. Yeah, kick the field goal, you push it to sudden death, but you're also kicking off and giving the other team the ball with a chance to kick a field goal and beat you. Get the touchdown. Finish the game off. That has to be the mindset.
Osweiler. And on the left side, Fedorowicz has it. And they'll take him down at the 31-yard line. 6 yards on the pickup, and it'll make it a second down.
How about the timing on that one? Boy, they were in sync, weren't they? Three-step drop, balls out of his hands, right to the tight end. Nice completion, just like they do it in practice.
So the offense readies for a second and four. From the gun, it's Osweiler. Fuller brings it in over the middle. And able to get this one across the 45 before he's brought down. And just a small glimpse there as to why they like this rookie so much.
And that's why they lit up a little bit in our meetings with the coaching staff, didn't
they? When we talked about him, they did.
Yeah, you know, they like his work ethic. You know, this guy's running every route well in the route tree and getting better at it all the time. Really honing his game. They expect a pretty good jump out of him as things continue to move on.
Throwing now, Osweiler on first down. And this is going to be incomplete. C.J. Fedorowicz, the intended receiver. And that'll bring up second down. Second down now after the incompletion. Osweiler will throw again. Hopkins on the grab over the middle. And he's brought down. A good pick up there on 20 yards. A partner, a great game that we got to see and making it extra special. Not only did I get four quarters with you in this one, I got some overtime, a little whipped cream on top.
Look at you, trying to make this.